Welcome to Real Estate Investing for Professional Men and Women, the podcast that guides professionals to financial prosperity. Join our community and let's start building your wealth. Here's your host, Gary Wilson.
Hi, everyone. This is Gary Wilson, and welcome to this week's podcast, Real Estate Investing for Professional Men and Women. I appreciate you listeners out there so far in close to 30 different countries, and we're growing pretty strongly here. So if you haven't already subscribed, please go ahead and do so. You can find it on Stitcher, iTunes, iHeartRadio, any one of 75 different channels. Again, it's Real Estate Investing for Professional Men and Women, who are people just like you, professional in your field, often business owner, and you do want to build some passive cash flow. So like for a dentist, you don't want to be stuck behind the chair when you're 60, 65 years old. You can leverage your business to acquire real estate and vice versa, and maybe bring somebody in to run your practice for you when you're ready to hit the links, so to speak. So in any case, you can join the community. Go to myinvestmentservices.com, click on members area, and you'll see another page pop up, and you can be one of the silver level members. I think they give you let you in for free in the beginning anyways, let you test the waters, and so to speak. But great community, folks just like us. And more importantly, we've trained well over 3,000 real estate agents across the U.S. and Canada and over 600 cities and towns to work specifically with you and I. So they're professionally trained. Their designation is investor agents. So make sure you look for that and ask for that. And more importantly, you can find them directly on that website on the community site. So in any case, without further ado, I want to welcome Mike Ayala. We're both members of two different mastermind groups. And a kind of interesting coincidence there, but Mike's been pretty successful in a number of ways. So Mike, let me go ahead and introduce you and have you, for those who don't know you, just kind of paint a picture of who you are. And then from there, we'll go forward into maybe some of the projects and get some details out there. Sound good?
Yeah, sounds great. I appreciate you for having me on. Look forward to it. So first and foremost, and I know everybody says this, but I'm a husband and a father, and that's one thing that I really pride myself on of all the things that we've done and gone through, for the most part, always seem to keep that first. So I've been married to my wife for 20 years. I have a 19-year-old son who's on his own running his own business, which pretty happy and proud of. And then I have a 17-year-old son and a 15-year-old daughter. So I'm kind of getting into my background. I started working early, like probably a lot of people in your group. And I actually started making suckers when I was in seventh grade. That was kind of my first foyer into business, and that went pretty well. Started cleaning doctor's offices actually when I was about 12 years old. My mom had a connection, and so I'd clean doctor's offices on the weekend, which was pretty fun and exciting. Went to work for a plumbing and heating company that I had a connection with when I was also 15 years old, and started spending the summers working there. After school, kind of trying to figure out what I wanted to do. I knew I didn't really want to go to college, but this guy that I'd been working for kept trying to push me into the apprenticeship program, which I finally decided to do. And that kind of led me to where I'm at today. Worked for that company for 5 more years, I want to say. Yeah. So till the age of 24, had a series of events that actually thrust me into leadership management, probably a little sooner than I should have, but I worked through it, had a good mentor, had some success with that. A partner and I left, and we started my first company when I was 24 years old, which, timing and some luck and some diligence really paid off there. We scaled double-digit growth year over year, ended up on the Inc. Fastest Growing Companies in America list in 2009, got that business to the point where I exited in 2014 at a $12 million valuation, actually sold to my partner. We were getting along fine, but just wanted to go in some different directions. And kind of all that really brought me to where I'm at today. Along the way, you know, like a lot of your listeners, we were making a lot of money. We were spinning off a lot of cash, had a lot of tax problems with our company, even though, you know, it was a construction company. We had a lot of write-offs with trucks, et cetera. But my accountant started advising us to invest in real estate. And that kind of started with commercial buildings. It made sense for us to own our own buildings. So we got into that a little bit, ended up with 4 different commercial buildings along the way. And then I got my hands on, the purple book, the Rich Dad, Poor Dad book, which really kind of started changing my way of thinking. And my wife and I, through a series of coaching events, we were doing this coaching with the company, and they basically started teaching us along the lines of, if your business is not helping you to achieve your personal goals, then you don't really have a business, you have a job. Mm-hmm. And so as we really started progressing down that, we determined that what we really wanted was 2 income producing properties a year for 10 years. That was kind of our goal. And at that point in time, we thought, wow, if we could just get to, you know, 20 income producing properties and have no debt on those by the time we retired, that would be our retirement plan, right? I knew I didn't want to work in this construction company for until I was 80 years old. So anyway, right out the gate, we ended up finding 2 properties, which we can discuss later if you want to. Got 2 single families done in the first year. And then all of a sudden this mobile home park fell in my lap, which I didn't really know anything about mobile home parks at that point in time, other than I'd done a lot of work on them, been involved in some development through the construction and the plumbing and heating company. But this was a fire sale deal, deal I couldn't pass up. Went to a mentor. He basically helped me get through the process of getting comfortable with that, buying that park. And so that's how I really got into the manufactured housing space. And I realized the first year we did 2 income producing properties a year. And then the second year, all of a sudden I've got 72 residents with this one acquisition. And so that really changed my mindset toward economies of scale and the real estate investing aspect. I did go on to acquire some portfolios. I got 45 more single family properties and a couple more commercial buildings, and then ended up with 5 mobile home communities. And then when I sold that company in 2014, I met my current partner, Andrew, and we teamed up and we started working toward what we're currently working on, which is 4 Peaks Capital Partners and Park Place Communities. And we're currently, outside of my portfolio, we're currently at 29 manufactured home communities, and that's kind of what we're working on at this stage. So that kind of gives you an overview of where I'm at and where I've been, and we can kind of open it up from there.
That's pretty awesome. Sounds like a pretty rapid growth projectile there, man. Right off the bat, two smaller purchases, and there was 78 unit mobile home park.
72.
That's amazing, man. And what's interesting is I've personally never been involved with mobile home parks, although some of my students have gone on to do that. And one of my favorite colleagues is Johnny Mark Rickard. He's in Albuquerque, not too far from me, maybe 6 hours to the east. And his dad was heavily in the mobile home parks, and he got into it. So I learned a lot. And the key was to own or control the land. And then, you know, the homes themselves, the mobile homes are kind of like secondary. I mean, it's a, you know, it can make money on them, obviously, but that was where they kind of figured things out, and just he ended up being on the radio. It's just an amazing story. So I've known a number of people that have had great success with that. And it's a little bit of a departure from traditional singles and duplexes, but it's an absolute major part of our real estate economy across the U.S. So I commend you for doing that. So let's talk a little bit about the what part. So you mentioned that first deal was for like a fire sale. And you've got, you know, 29 different properties. Talk a little bit about structuring the deal. So like when you're working with banks, or if you're working with private lenders, or what's your favorite technique, or what are you actually doing when you're acquiring a mobile home park when it comes to structuring the deal? You know, what it may be finding it and then structuring the deal.
Yeah, so it's obviously different today than it was, you know, back in the day when we first got started. So I guess I'll just start on what we're looking for and targeting today. Mm-hmm. The majority of the properties that we buy, we have several different general partnerships. We of course have 4 Peaks Capital Partners, where we've got a group of investors that invest directly with us. And then we have several other different general partnerships. And so step one is really identifying the property and what type of asset is it going to be? What's the turnaround strategy, if there is one? Is it a more stabilized process? Are we getting debt out the gate? Because as you can imagine, when we're buying a 100 space community that needs a heavy turnaround, let's say it's 35, 40% occupied, the type of investor that wants to go into that is completely different than the type of investor that wants an asset that's 90% occupied and is stabilized and throwing off cash flow from day one. So step one is kind of identifying what bucket does this property fit in. Obviously, I guess I'll say generally speaking, a more stabilized asset that can get a higher level of better debt is going to have lower IRRs, just generally speaking. Mm-hmm. We're a vertically integrated company, so we've got our property management company in-house. We control the construction side. And so we're pretty good on the turnaround project. And I would say we probably do 3 turnarounds for every 1 stabilized property. So wow. That's kind of our model today. We can get into the weeds on that a little bit if you want. But what we're really looking for is several different types of property, and then we just align it with a certain investment group and go from there.
Okay. So you are bringing in outside investors and are you raising capital? Are they more like equity partners? Are they simply as a more like a loan type scenario, or profit sharing, or some combination, or what's I know I've seen all variety of combinations of things, but what would you say is the most common, or what can, if somebody listens to this and doesn't know about this, what would be the most common thing to help them understand the process of the bringing in the investors?
Yeah. So generally speaking, it's an equity position. And so we'll generally bring in equity. We can discuss some of the types of deals have debt on them. Again, whether it's stabilized or not, we'll determine whether there's debt today. But our favorite type of deal is a big turnaround project. So again, on 100 spaces, let's say it's 50% occupied, we're going to turn this project around. And so it's really an equity piece. So if an investor comes in with $100,000, they buy a share in that particular LLC. Mm-hmm. We typically do an 80-20 split. That's typical. We've got a couple different setups. So we typically do an 8 pref. So what that really means at the end of the day, some of your investors may understand this, some of them may not. Before we get paid, of course, we take our asset management fees and we take our property management fees. But before we get paid, they get their 8% preferred return. And so above and beyond that, we split everything 80-20. And so as the operator, you know, it's really our goal to get these parks to a level where they're performing, because we obviously want to clear that pref hurdle and then get to the point where we're getting paid. So yeah, it's typically an equity position. We do have another opportunity, which again, we can get more into detail if you think it's interesting to your audience, mm-hmm. but we do have a debt fund that places debt on the actual mobile homes themselves.
Mm-hmm.
The park LLCs will guarantee that. And so the interesting thing about that particular fund, you're not invested in one particular park. You're issuing mortgages that are within a fund that are issuing mortgages across a lot of different parks. And that's a fixed flat percentage return based on the amount of money that you invest.
Interesting. Okay. Or let's do this. We can get into more details in a bit, but geographically speaking, are your properties in and around the Arizona, New Mexico, things like that? Or have you branched out into other parts of the country, or US or Canada for that matter?
Yeah. So as you know, we're based in Gilbert, Arizona. Our corporate office is. We do have one park. We have one community in Tucson, Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
Several communities in Nevada, and then kind of our outlier on the opposite end is North Carolina, and then mm-hmm. Alabama to the south. But everything else is really centrally located in the Middle West, in the Midwest. Indiana, Illinois, Kansas, Ohio, just Middle America. That's where the majority of our properties are.
Gotcha. Okay. It's sort of the west, southwest part of the Rust Belt, east part of the Heartland, and that's really sort of for decades that was sort of the breadbasket. I mean, before everything, we're really sort of moving west migration wise, and so I've been out there a lot. I mean, in Ohio, and we do a lot of investing in Ohio, Indiana, Southern Illinois. I mean, Northern Kentucky. Just it's an amazing. In fact, Columbus is one of the fastest growing areas in the country and one of the most desirable places to be, the highest percentage of higher educated people, and just an amazing place. And it's Ohio. I mean, even people would never really think of Ohio, but that's where it's happening, you know? So if you notice a difference when between buying a mobile home park in Arizona versus, let's say, you take the one in North Carolina, was there a difference in structuring the deal, or a difference in pricing? What would you say, was there any learning curve for you there when you went into North Carolina? It was different than what you were experiencing in Arizona, you know?
Yeah, it's actually interesting that you pick those two. Arizona is definitely interesting. And the reason why we probably don't own more communities here is because we're definitely in the affordable housing space. We're looking at providing safe, clean, affordable housing for mm-hmm. middle America. That's kind of our niche. And when we get into like the Arizona type markets, California, even Nevada, mm-hmm. A lot of these are retirement type communities. And that's not really that's not really our model. That being said, they're much more expensive. I mean, you look at some of the lot rents in Arizona and they're $800 a month.
Mm-hmm.
Our average lot rent is $285 a month across our portfolio. And so we're really focused on that affordable housing piece. I'm not saying I wouldn't love having more properties in Arizona, but it really just doesn't fit our model. And right. then we get into North Carolina. The interesting thing about North Carolina, and this is true for any new state that you go into, there's obviously different types of local restrictions, local municipalities, but then the county has a lot of impact on that too. And then obviously the state. North Carolina is actually not a bad state for us to do business in. It's just that we just only have one community there. And so we're mm-hmm. looking for economies of scale. And when we target these areas, we're looking for areas at this stage that we can actually, grow our presence there. And I'm not sure we haven't found any more deals in North Carolina that make a lot of sense to us. So, you know, the consolidation effort just doesn't exist there at this point in time. I'm not saying it won't. The other interesting thing about our North Carolina property, which isn't really, it's the market that we bought in. It's a military town. And so you kind of made reference to this earlier, but we learned something there. And this was one of our earlier acquisitions. We don't necessarily want to own the homes. Our goal at the end of the day is to have home ownership for our residents. And when you're in a heavily, you're in a town with a heavy military presence, there's a lot of people there that are just looking for rentals. So that was another thing that we learned along the way, and it didn't really have anything necessarily to do with North Carolina. It was just that particular market.
Yeah. Is it, if you don't mind asking, is it Fayetteville?
No, it's just outside of Jacksonville.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
You're up along the coast then.
Yep.
Yeah. So I've got family out there. I'm pretty familiar with the area. So, used to be, you could actually drive across that base there going from the beaches to the south to the beaches to the north. They let you pass through the base. It was the craziest thing. But great part of the country, you know, very, very temperate. Doesn't get too cold in the winter. It gets really hot in the summer, though. But, you know, lots of good surfing, fishing, and things like that. So well, let's talk about, okay, so I got a better picture geographically speaking now, but let's talk about timing. So you mentioned in where you were back in 2009, here it is 10 years later. And obviously between 2009, we're like, you know, the recession is at or near the bottom. And now, of course, we appear to be at the peak of a market. But have you had to get creative on your strategies relative to timing, or any big lessons there? And maybe it's combined with geography too, because I noticed the recession kind of rolled through the country. Different parts of the country got into the party later than others, which is crazy, you know. But as far as timing, what have you noticed there, and what would you say you could share lesson wise when it comes to timing on these things?
Well, the interesting, obviously, in any asset class that you're in, there's going to be ebbs and flows and cycles that you've got to watch out for. The cycle that we're currently in, cap rates are being compressed. A lot more people are interested in this market, obviously. And so we're seeing that currently. It's getting harder to find deals. Mm-hmm. We're still finding deals because of our broker relations, number one, but number two, because of our ability to turn projects around that other people can't necessarily, I wouldn't say they can't do it, but because we're vertically integrated and we control the construction and the management company, we can do it faster. But going back to kind of the previous timeline, the 2009s, all that, if you look at actually the three publicly traded mobile home park operators, they actually recorded record profits during that time.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, everybody wants to say that and point out these great things about their asset class. I bring this up because, you know, these guys have presence across the country. Getting back to ours, you know, I didn't have a lot of properties at that point in time, but we kind of cruised through it. We were in a unique area, so area definitely has something to do with it. I was actually in a gold mining community, so it's a little unfair you know, really benchmark my property to the rest of the country, because obviously as we're going into a recession or there's economic troubles brewing, gold's doing well. And so our economy was actually on fire during that time. So I would love to just say, hey, you know what, every single mobile home park is going to perform positively through a recession. But to your point, there's different areas in the market or in the country itself that are just going to perform different. We're seeing some, you know, even middle America right now, we're watching some reports on, you know, U.S. steel issues across the board with trade tariffs and all that kind of stuff. But the one thing I will say for the asset class in general, we are definitely on the affordable housing side, as I've already said.
Right.
As issues begin to brew, people are looking for more and more affordable housing. And this is, you know, my partner actually always says that as things compress and get worse, class A goes to B and B goes to C and C goes to D, and people are looking for more affordable housing. And so that's a positive for us. And I don't want to get too negative on this, but really, if you can't afford, you know, a $550 to a $750 a month home payment for a relatively nice home, you don't have a lot of options after that. So.
Right.
We're pretty happy with the asset class overall, and it did pretty well through the recession.
Well, it definitely serves a need. And my gosh, I live part time in Canada. I'm actually up here now in Toronto. We live out in London, Ontario, which is 2 hours to the west of Toronto. And of course, you live in the States too. But one of her neighbors in a condo community here where we are had recently, you know, 2 years ago, sold their single family home, moved into the condo because they want to travel all over the world, which is what they do. And now they're even taking a step further, and they literally just bought a $40,000 mobile home and located the place where they're going to park it, where they're going to pay a monthly rent. I don't know what they're paying. I didn't think to ask them that, but they love it because they also have their own RV, and it allows them to have the mobile home and the RV, and they literally every winter they take the RV and go all the way down to central Mexico and do mission work and help a local church down there, and then come back in the warmer months and enjoy the Canadian summer weather. It's like, and so it's funny because, you know, they're actually being proactive and they're choosing that as a lifestyle factor, not necessarily because they're in Canada, we call them RSPs, which is your retirement fund. Theirs didn't get wiped out. In fact, when we had the recession in the States, Canadians were cruising right along. I mean, it was crazy. But it's interesting. A lot of people think of, okay, when a recession hits, it makes sense that fewer people are buying, so more people will rent. So when you have a relatively fixed asset class like rentals, it, of course, drives up rent. So the reason I mention this is going back to what you said a few moments ago, if someone can't afford a $500 to $750 monthly house payment, there's not many options. And part of the reason is a lot of their rents have really gone up. I mean, inventory is tight. Vacancy rates are still historically low. I mean, some areas like 1%, 2%. And if you think about it, there's other factors at play, like take colleges and universities. In a recession, enrollment actually goes up, you know? So if you have rentals in those areas, again, you've got a relatively fixed asset class and you can add more rentals, it just takes time, but it drives up the rents. And we're seeing student housing rental rates just going through the roof, and they're luxury places compared to what I went to when I was in college, you know? Yeah. So a lot of interesting dynamics. And so the reason I'm bringing this up, the bigger picture is this, is, you know, we call limiting beliefs. A lot of people think, well, you know, it's the economy's going to be going down. I don't necessarily believe that. It will eventually, but we're really strong. I just looked at a bunch of reports and I'm seeing some stabilizing in the real estate world. But overall, the U.S. is more money's pouring into the U.S. than ever before. It's just, I mean, it's going to take a big 2x4 to crush this economy. It's going to happen. I'm not saying it's not going to happen, but it might be years down the road. Who knows? The point I'm trying to make is when it comes to investing, investors are really in the game and they study it. They're students of the game, realize you can always invest. There's always something to invest in. We never actually stop investing. We just want to know what the economy is doing so we can apply the right strategy. And the mobile home business is one of those asset classes a lot of people don't pay attention to. And yet I meet guys like you and it's like you're just cruising right along. And I'm not saying it's easy, but it seems like you're able to grow and you maybe don't have to worry about as much competition like you do for people buying typical fourplexes and tenplexes and things like that. I mean, it just seems to be that's the observation. So I don't want to, maybe now you're probably thinking, okay, Gary, stop talking.
No.
Bring all these people in. But if you could, maybe touch, we're doing okay on time. If you could touch a little bit about on maybe what's a method you're using, a favorite method on locating the mobile home parks. Because maybe it's traditional methods, maybe it's not, but I might shed some light on that for some people like a dentist wanting to participate with you might be curious about, well, how do you actually locate them, you know?
Yeah. If I could just, before you said a lot of really interesting things there. And I, before I jump into that, if I could just back up and, yeah. You know, I've always kind of looked at this. I learned real estate investing with my own money, not other people's capital. Not that, you know, we don't make mistakes still, but when I look at just everything that you just said, I mean, at the end of the day, yeah, we're going to go through ups and downs. We're going to go through recessions. My thing has always been, how do I control, you know, my asset through that? And I actually, we're in a group together called GoBundance, and we were recently at an event in Austin, and David Osborne had his chief investment officer there. The guy's name's Mike. And he made a comment when he's looking at a deal, any deal, because they, you know, they get shown a lot of deals all the time. He made the comment, you know, everybody's always coming in and they're talking about this turnaround strategy and everything relies on refinancing that park, right? Build, you know, gaining equity through a refinance or whatever. Not all of them, but a lot of them do. And he made a comment. He said, at some stage, what they're really looking for, at some stage, the economy's going to come back. And no matter what, we need housing. No matter what, we need office space to a degree. No matter what, we're going to need, you know, Circle K's and gas stations. That, well, maybe Tesla does away with that. I don't know, but we'll see.
Yeah.
But his whole thing was, at some stage, that's going to come back. The most important part of all this is, can we get through whatever timeline that is? And so you've got all these You got all these people out there right now buying multifamily and all these different things, which I'm not against multifamily. I have some and I love it. But everything relies on a value add. So we're going to buy this property and we're going to pour a bunch of money into it and we're going to double our money in 2 years. Mm-hmm. Well, that's all fine and great. But Mike brought up something that I think is extremely valuable. What if that doesn't happen? Mm-hmm. What if we do hit a recession? What if we do have housing issues? Is there enough cash flow in that property to get you through to the other side to where you can refinance? And so I'm kind of in your camp, whether there is or isn't a recession, any of that, we just need to be looking at something that people need with or without ups and downs. Mm-hmm. And no matter what, a recession is going to affect all of us. But the reality at the end of the day, affordable housing, the need for that is just going to go up and up and up. And so manufactured housing is not the only area where you can invest in affordable housing. And another thing that I heard you really say that, a lot of people only want to buy stuff that's sexy, class A properties, right? Mm-hmm. Like Grant Cardone's doing. Well, yeah, that mm-hmm. sounds fine and great. But the reality at the end of the day, is it sustainable? Mobile home parks are not sexy. And you said, a lot of people don't think about it. And a lot of people have this idea in their head that a manufactured home community is a certain type of individual. It's not for me. I love the story you told about your friends that are traveling. I grew up in a one bedroom, one bath, 1975 single wide with a brother and a sister and a mom and a dad. And those are some of my best memories ever. I didn't realize that I was in a mobile home park, right? So anyway, I just wanted to touch on that because I think you hit some great things. There's a stigma that comes along with it, but really at the end of the day, these are your neighbors. This is middle America. These are the people that we work with every single day. This is the nice lady down the street that you see every day at the Circle K. These are generally good people. And we've got this stigma about mobile home parks that we're actually working to change because we love our residents. So anyway, thank you for letting me...
You're welcome, man. I appreciate it. Yeah. This is the kind of stuff that people... I love doing these because these parts of the conversation, I think, is what sticks with people. They realize they get the minutia of what we're talking about and they can see themselves doing this, as a result. So thank you for doing that, man.
Yeah, I appreciate it. So your question was how do we identify, locate deals, et cetera? And some of it is the traditional methods. We have broker relationships that we've built. We have a guy that works with us. His name's Dan. He's our director of acquisitions and he does a really good job. We're churning through a lot of deals, obviously, but he does a good job of kind of helping our brokers to understand exactly what we're looking for. And a lot of time that kind of narrows down the cycle, if you will. If brokers are not sending us 100 deals, they're narrowing it down through their filter and our filter to get us down to 10 deals. It's a lot less deals that we have to churn through. We've got several, of all the deals we've closed in the last couple of years, the majority of them have been with a few different brokerage groups. And I don't want to say they're pocket listings per se, but a lot of times we'll get a first look. There's only ever been one deal in our history that we didn't close on, and it was a very small deal in Ponca City, which actually was probably the best thing that ever happened to us. But the seller backed out at the end. He decided he didn't want to sell. And so when we go into an LOI phase and then furthering that, a contract phase, we have a pretty good idea that we're going to follow through and close on that unless something major comes up in due diligence. And then we should all be big enough to kind of renegotiate. So as far as looking at deals, the traditional method, we got brokers working in our corner. One thing that I found interesting, and we didn't really intentionally set out to do this, but you're huge on this, Gary, and I can see it just meeting you through Strategic Coach and GoBundance. Give back. The very first boss that I worked for in the plumbing and heating world, he always said that we owe it to donate our time to teach all that kind of stuff. And so believe it or not, that's actually become a huge revenue source. It's become, I'm not a paid coach, so it's not a revenue source. It's actually become a great lead source. I had Ken Eslick and Rock Thomas from M1 reach out to me.
Yeah.
They had a particular woman that's in M1 that was buying her first mobile home park. And Ken had mentioned to me, hey, Mike, can you just reach out to this particular person and just, kind of guide her along the way, make sure she's, not going to fall into the oblivion. And so I had a call with this particular person and coached her through her first acquisition. We actually just had another call a couple of days ago, but it's been interesting because she's actually brought me through that conversation. I've helped her identify what her niche is and she understands what mine is. And she's actually brought two deals to the table that were too big for her. It was too big of a turnaround project that we're actually moving forward on because she has real clarity on what we're looking for and she has real clarity on what she's not looking for. And so the reason why I bring all that up is we didn't really look at this as a revenue source, but we've actually found a lot of deals by helping a lot of other people, mentoring them through the process. And then they understand how we do things. And when they see a deal that's not good for them, they kick it over to us. That's actually been a huge benefit to the give back mission. So,
yeah. Well, I appreciate that. You're absolutely right. I mean, it's, I know people ask me all the time, well, why do you teach if you got all this stuff and you're doing so great, why do you teach? And there's an old saying, I think it was St. Francis said, for those who believe, no words are necessary. For those who don't, no words are possible. It's same thing with this giving philosophy and this culture we have. I can't explain it words. I can try to tell you what it feels like. It feels pretty darn good. I mean, it's fulfilling when a student not just succeeds and excels, but actually passes you. I mean, no greater compliment than when a student passes you and is outproducing you. Anybody ever taught a child how to ride a bike? When they're 5 years old, they're taking the training wheels off. They're like, they're free. They're riding their training wheels. And you look in the background and there's the mom or dad jumping up and down with their hands up. Well, that's what it feels like, you know? So hopefully that'll explain to people, but I get a lot of it. I learn a lot from doing these things. I learn a lot from teaching others because they'll have some little thing they tried. And it just, that constant being out there and coming from service, you do prosper too, by the way. I've had situations where I took one of my apartment complexes, turned it over, 78 unit apartment complex, turned it over time to be a safe place for refugee families from Burma and Nepal. Started off just 25% of the units through, it was a joint venture with Catholic Charities and St. Vincent de Paul Society. And I said, sure, I'll do that because I've done that before with some families from Bosnia back in the late 90s. And it's a great way to kind of have that alignment of giving and receiving. So in any case, I did this, Mike, and then it turned over another 25%. Eventually, this thing was majority refugee family. It turns out it outperformed itself before I turned it over. It was like, because they pay their rent on time. It was like it'd be a dishonor to the family to not pay their rent. So it was real. Everybody paid their rent. And they were the most wonderful people. I mean, I got to know the culture. I learned a lot. I got to know the grandparents and the grandkids. It was the most amazing thing. So I hope everybody kind of takes that to heart, because whatever you're doing in life, you can leverage as a form of ministry. And if you're into real estate like Mike and I are, man, maybe every now and then take a house and turn it over to a safe house for battered women with children or people recovering addicts or things like that. And believe it or not, there are agencies and associations that will pay you to do that. So you're providing a great service and yet you're still profitable. We call it prosperity through service. So when you turn that corner, guys, I promise you, most people I know who are really successful in life have experienced the same thing. And again, it's not anything you can kind of write in a book, at least that I'm aware of. You just have to experience it. Just give yourself permission to do it. It all starts with you, though, taking action and learning from guys like Mike, reaching out. So by the way, Mike, if we could, we're getting short on time here. If people want to reach out to you, do you have like a website, a podcast, special report, or a book, or anybody that wants to invest with you? What's the best way for people to learn more about you and what you've been able to accomplish and perhaps participate, you know?
Yeah. So first I'll just start with Four Peaks is our capital arm. So the website for that is www.4, spelled out F-O-U-R, peakspartners.com. Mm-hmm. And we actually do have a report that we hand out a lot. It's www.reservedinvestments.com. And it's a due diligence guide to private investments. So it'll kind of help people that have done a lot of it and then ones that don't too. We just kind of created a checklist alongside with our attorney of things that people should be looking for when they are investing with people who are raising capital, equity firms, et cetera. So www.reservedinvestments.com, you can download that free private guide. So I am in the process of launching a podcast, but it's a little bit down the road, but it's along the lines of what we've been talking about. It has, it's all around leverage, and we're just going to talk about ways that people leverage time, relationship, people, money, partnerships, all that kind of stuff. So, but we're not there yet.
If you need help there, I'll tell you what, I'll shoot you some information. It might help you get that moving a little bit faster. I know I looked at it for a year. I used to do one years ago and was actually quite successful. In fact, in the fourth week, it was ranked the third most popular podcast in its genre, even ahead of Gary Keller and Keller Williams. It was even ahead of his. But I didn't know what I was doing with it. We didn't know how to actually you know, monetize. So we just stopped. It was like, it's taking up time. We finally met the right company and called ROI Predictive. So I'll make an introduction for you because of that guy and his company, Stephen Wessner. That's why I have what I have today. And it's been less than a year. Amazing guidance. And I think you'll get a lot from that. I'll just at least, you know, talk to him and see what you think, you know.
Awesome, Gary. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Hey, listen, I want to say thanks, Mike, from the bottom of my heart and for everybody listening, for sharing your valuable time and your expertise. And I look forward to seeing you again in one of the Go Abundance events. I'll definitely be there at, I think we're going to Aspen this year for the big winter event. Yep. And I'll see, I think it's October back in Toronto for Strategic Coach. So in any case, let's stay in touch, man. The wheels are spinning. I got some ideas for us possibly if you're interested. I'll run them by you. So that's one of the reasons why I love doing this. But thank you for doing this. Thank you, everybody, for listening. Again, if you like this, go ahead and subscribe to the podcast, Real Estate Investing for Professional Men and Women. Also, go to the MyInvestorServices.com website. Plug yourself in. Be part of the community. Learn from each other. Do joint ventures. And make sure you got those investor agents working on your behalf because they're trained to work with us. They're not like regular agents, okay? So in any case, we will see you on the next podcast. In the meantime, you guys take care and God bless. Bye.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Real Estate Investing for Professional Men and Women. Be sure to go to myinvestmentservices.com to join our community and start building wealth today.